Hello friends, it's me, JJ. So, having recently passed 100,000 subscribers, I figured it was time for another Q&A video, the YouTuber's most beloved filler material. I solicited comments from my channel's community tab, from my Instagram account, from the JJ Discord server, even from email. And as usual, I got several hundred more questions than I could ever possibly hope to answer. But I did read them all, and I tried to curate a somewhat random assortment that covered a broad range of topics, including personal stuff, political stuff, and some random nonsense. So to begin, I noticed that a few questions tended to be asked over and over and over again. So here is the official JJ FAQ. Frequently asked question number one. What is your opinion on Brexit? Well, I don't really have very strong feelings about it because there are a lot of things about Brexit I don't understand, and frankly, I don't think I could ever understand, not being British. I say this because Brexit seems much less like a debate over a tangible policy issue and much more like a sort of national psychodrama about the kind of country Britain wants to be in the 21st century, which is honestly not a topic I have very strong feelings on. Although I guess you could say that my indifference is itself kind of a revealing statement on my opinion of Britain's place in the modern world. One relatively strong anti-Brexit opinion I do have, however, is kind of resistance to this idea that you sometimes hear from the sort of pro-Brexit people that post-Brexit Britain is going to have this like amazing revived relationship with the nations of the Commonwealth. I think that A, this is not a remotely practical idea, as I explained in a whole other video I made, and B, I resent the implication that it is somehow the job of Canada or Australia or anywhere else to drop everything and sort of help cushion the blow from a decision that Britain made for itself. Frequently asked question number two. Who do you think is going to win the Canadian general election in October? I think Prime Minister Trudeau will be re-elected, and I think he will probably be re-elected by a larger margin than is currently fashionable to predict. My thinking is that the Liberal Party will lose seats in Western Canada, but will compensate for it with gains in Quebec and possibly some parts of Ontario just because of a truly disastrous NDP showing. But even that is a way more specific prediction than I generally like to give. So we can all have a lot of fun looking back at this clip on October 22nd and laughing at how wrong I was. But obviously I will make more videos about Canadian election analysis as we get closer to it. Number three, who is going to win the Democrat nomination and who is going to win the 2020 presidential election? Well, I just assume Biden will be the nominee. At this point, there would have to be a pretty dramatic earthquake in the party for that not to be the case. I've heard it said that Biden is polling better with Democrats right now than Trump was at this point of the last election with the Republicans. And I suspect that Biden will eventually lose to Trump. I don't really have a very sophisticated theory about this. I just think as a general rule, it's usually pretty safe to bet on the incumbent. I could see it going down a lot like 2016, where Trump narrowly wins in the Electoral College despite losing the popular vote. Fact number four, when are you going to continue the World Leaders series? So a while ago, I started a video series slowly profiling the leaders of every country on Earth. And then I just stopped. I have explained why elsewhere, but never in a video before, so here goes. Those videos took a lot of time to make since I was literally having to research and write like 10 condensed biographies a week. And frankly, the resulting videos were just not popular enough with you guys for me to continue to justify spending that kind of time on them. And I don't blame most of you for finding them kind of boring. I found them kind of boring too. The flawed premise of the series was that world leaders are inherently interesting people. But what I learned after profiling like 50 of them is that most presidents and prime ministers are just kind of these relatively dull career politicians who have like slowly climbed the government ladder after a couple of decades. There's only so many times I can tell those kind of stories and keep it interesting. Fact number five, what are your hobbies? I actually don't have too many. I like to draw. I like to play video games once in a while, although I am by no definition a gamer. One sort of eccentric thing that I like to do is walk really long distances, like go on a 2-hour walk from one end of a city to another. If I lived in a universe with infinite time, I would probably go everywhere by walking, just because I really like it. Frequently asked question number six, can you say something nice about Quebec? Well, Quebec of course has many very positive qualities. You know, like the Quebec, the farms? All right, now let's do some Patreon questions. Eric Kloss asks, What is your process to write a YouTube video? It's not that hard for me to come up with ideas. I'm usually working on several scripts simultaneously and have a lot of different ideas bouncing around in my brain. I do a surprising amount of writing on my phone, which I guess is sort of a testament to how much I'm just kind of writing all of the time, all over the place. I do a lot of my research at the library, just because I don't want to be using sources that are just regurgitated Google results or Wikipedia articles. I actually really hate Wikipedia and never use it, so I guess that's kind of a fun fact about me. Amelia Wildman asks me to explain the concept of red Tories versus blue Tories. So this is a fairly misunderstood concept in Canadian politics. Basically, at some point during the latter half of the 20th century, Canada had a party flip, kind of like the party flip that they had in America. So the Liberal Party, which had traditionally been more conservative on certain issues, became more left-wing on those issues, whereas the Conservative Party, which had traditionally been more left-wing on those same issues, became more right-wing on them. It wasn't a perfectly clean across-the-board thing, because there are certainly issues where you can see that the Conservatives have always been relatively conservative, and there are some issues where you can say the Liberal Party has always been relatively left-wing. And of course, a lot of this is bound up in, well, what does it mean to be left-wing, and what does it mean to be right-wing? But there has definitely been a big party switch on issues involving trade and relations with America, and sort of what we could call kind of big government issues more broadly. And just as there existed a faction of conservative Democrats after America's party flip, so too did there exist a faction of so-called red Tories after Canada's. These were some of the most contemptible figures in Canadian politics, in my opinion, because they were basically big government-loving America haters. But anyway, these days a lot of this history has been forgotten, and the media will just kind of lazily use the term red Tory to mean any moderate member of the Conservative Party. Jack Versace asks, I was wondering your opinion on how pop culture and media have influenced the attitudes and moral values of teens and adults throughout the decades. This whole business about to what degree does the media and pop culture influence broader society is, I think, one of the great unanswerable questions of modern life. And I think you see this reflected in the rather incoherent way people tend to answer it. If you ask a question like, do video games make people violent? A lot of people will be like, no, look at these empirical studies and, you know, that kind of thing. But then when you ask a sort of broader question like, does the media affect what we think is cool or sexy or ugly? Most people will be like, yes, of course, it's no debate. I guess I'm of the opinion that pop culture is maybe best understood as a force that can kind of normalize and encourage public sentiments that are sort of already there. For example, consider the depiction of LGBT people in the media in the late 90s and early 2000s. I think you could argue that there was a kind of symbiosis happening in which public attitudes were already becoming more tolerant, but sympathetic portrayals of LGBT people in pop culture also helped provide validation and encouragement to that public as well. So I really don't think you can have one without the other. And I suspect that to the extent pop culture has ever influenced this or that generation in one direction or another, it has always been a very cooperative process. All right, and now a couple questions from the Discord. VFSDM asks, can you describe your type of humor? Well, the sort of humor that makes me laugh the loudest is just really absurd, stupid stuff. Like, this is one of my favorite all-time jokes from The Simpsons.
Look. He painted a unicorn in outer space. I'm asking you, what's it breathing?
Air?
Ain't no air in space.
There's an air in space museum.
I really like the sort of humor that comes from people not taking things seriously or just being really incompetent at something. For example, another thing I find way more hilarious than I like to admit is those videos where the boyfriend tries to do the girlfriend's makeup for her. It makes me laugh just thinking about it because it is so stupid. Mr. Boy asks, what's your least favorite video of yours? Well, I've never really disliked a video that I've made all that much. I mean, some of the older videos are on kind of strange topics that I would never make a video about today, but you know, I'm aware that those were just sort of part of my learning curve as I got to this point. I guess the video I'm most embarrassed by is the Jagmeet Singh video. At the time, I really did genuinely think he was going to be this very big force in Canadian politics, when it turns out he's been one of the biggest flops of all time. I think I projected a lot of skills onto the man he just objectively did not possess, because I just kind of liked the story that I thought he represented. All right, now the top voted community tab questions. Alex asks, you become Supreme Leader of Canada. The US decides to let you take 10 of their states as a gift. Which 10 states do you take for Canada and why? Wow, a full fifth of the US. I have barely even been to 10 states, so I guess for this to be a remotely well-informed decision, I would just have to go with the 10 I have spent the most time in, which would be Washington, Oregon, California, Arizona, Florida, Texas, New York, Minnesota, Massachusetts, and Pennsylvania. Sorry, Nevada. Tamin asks, do you think YouTube is silencing young conservatives like Ben Shapiro, Steven Crowder, or even you? I talked about this a bit in my VidCon video, and I would say no. I think YouTube is probably a little bit too nervous in flagging problematic content, but I do think that conservatives should get out of their bubble a little bit on this. There are so many other communities on YouTube, including many communities on the left, who have similar martyr complexes about being silenced, which makes me think that the problem is much more structural than political. Yuki Otoku asks, you've talked briefly about your experience teaching in Japan. I know you felt isolated, but would you recommend teaching in Japan to someone else? What was the most interesting slash surprising part of life in Japan to you? I don't think I would recommend it, but it obviously depends a lot on the person. A line I used to use was that in order to have a good experience teaching English in Japan, you should ideally be passionate about two of the following three things. English, Japan, or teaching. And I wasn't really passionate about any of those things. I was just kind of vaguely interested in doing something in a foreign land, and in retrospect, that was not a strong enough motivation. Most interesting or surprising thing about the country? Well, I guess one thing was just sort of how generally bad at English the Japanese are. In a lot of other countries, educated middle-class people tend to be relatively good at basic conversational English, but this was not the case in Japan, in my experience, which is the whole reason why they had to import foreigners like me. Shane Sheffield asks, where did your love for the United States come from and why, since most Canadians hate the United States? I grew up in a very pro-American family. Both my parents actually wanted to emigrate to the United States at various times, and as a result, I don't think I was really raised in the climate of casual anti-Americanism that I think most Canadians are. My parents would often take us on vacations to the US, and they would always praise everything about America. To this day, I think the only really consistently anti-American thing that my parents ever say is that Americans are too fat. But beyond that, I also grew up with a strong sense that, you know, it was bad to discriminate and stereotype. And I realized early on that a lot of the ways that Canadians talk about Americans is just a kind of lazy prejudice that seems designed to stir up hatred and division for its own sake. And I'm just not into that. Mr. Confused asks, what country do you want to visit most in each continent? That is a fun question. In North America, I would legitimately like to visit Greenland someday. I've always had a fascination with it, even before its recent entry into the headlines. In South America, I would basically like to visit anywhere, but I'm hoping to visit Chile soon because I have a friend that lives there. It will be my first time on the continent. In Africa, I would really like to visit South Africa, which I'm also hoping to arrange a trip to someday soon. In Asia, I would like to go back to Japan just to see how things have changed since I was there. But if I had to pick somewhere new, I would really like to go to India. And in Europe, I would really like to visit somewhere in like the Balkans, like Serbia or Kosovo. I've spent a lot of time in wealthy Western European countries, and I would like to see what life is like in some of the poor eastern parts. Mike Carey asks, have your political views changed since your earlier YouTube days? If yes, how? Not really. I guess I would say I'm a little bit more comfortable in my identity as a kind of unapologetically moderate conservative than I was in 2015. But the conservative brand has also become a lot more toxic than when I started, so I guess it makes sense that I would be a little bit more standoffish about it now. Alan Endicott asks, so, Terrence and Philip, thoughts? I like Terrence and Philip. As you can see, I have little toys of them on my shelf here. Even though they're pretty dumb, obnoxious characters, I like what they're supposed to satirize. I've read early interviews with Trey Parker and Matt Stone, and what they have said is that the original joke behind Terrence and Philip is that there is something sort of inherently absurd about portraying Canadians, who are basically indistinguishable from Americans, as like this other species. But I think this joke really goes over the heads of a lot of Canadians. They think Terrence and Philip are supposed to be like a commentary on American ignorance of legitimate Canadian differences. But no, the joke is on us. Eon Miller says, what do you believe is your biggest milestone in real life? I'd like it to not be YouTube affiliated though. I like this question because it sort of forces me to reflect on what I've actually done with my life. I have no children, I've never been married, no one important to me has died. I've never really had any significant moves. I mean, I lived in Japan for a year, but that seems like a very fleeting moment in retrospect. Honestly, one of the biggest milestones for me was probably when I started appearing on television for the first time. That would have been like in 2011 or so. That was a big milestone for me because I felt validated in having reached a certain level of fame and legitimacy as a public figure, and that was always something that was very important to me. Walking into the TV studio for the very first time is an experience that is very burned into my brain. The first time I saw one of my cartoons published in an actual physical book was a big deal for me as well, for similar reasons. I can still remember the very first day I picked it up at a bookstore. It was the day before Thanksgiving. Here is a question from email from Matt Borku. On your recommendation, I'm going to read Dynasties and Interludes, but I was wondering what other books on Canadian history /politics would you recommend? So, Dynasties and Interludes, for anybody who doesn't know, is a very good book about Canadian political history that I recommended in a previous video. Another good one would be this one, Canada and Quebec, One Country, Two Histories. I actually do own a physical copy of this book, I just can't seem to find it. It's sort of an oral history of Quebec, as told by a bunch of academics and journalists and politicians and so on. It's a book that does a very good job of showing all of the different ways it is possible to think about the role of French Canadians in Quebec in broader sort of Canadian society and history. This book, National Dreams by Daniel Francis, was very influential to me. The author looks at various things that have been used to stir up a sense of Canadian patriotism over the years, like the British Empire or the Mounties, and explores the way that these symbols were deliberately constructed and marketed to the Canadian people with varying degrees of success. And then there is this book, Canada and the Canadian Question by Goldwin Smith. This is a book from the late 19th century that was written by a Scottish immigrant to Canada. I think this is a very remarkable book because he is very critical of Canadian nationalism, but also critical in a way that still feels very modern. It's a book that really shows how a lot of Canada's problems are rooted in what are basically anti-American design flaws. All right, now let's do some Instagram questions. Cole Maximum asks me for my favorite meme. Well, one that I remember making me laugh a lot was one that somebody made on the eve of President Trump's trip to North Korea, when Trump and Trudeau were like having this big feud. This one here. May98 asks, what have you found to be the most challenging aspect of being a YouTuber? Probably just the production schedule. I like making weekly videos, but man, I am often working like right up until the very last second in order to have a video ready for every Saturday. Amani Gillings asks, do you plan on doing any other projects other than YouTube? I would really like to make a book, but I would also really like to make another fancy website, kind of like my Canada guide. What do you think I should do? Nate Kip asks, what are your thoughts on the Electoral College? I feel like this topic has been done to death, but I would still like to make a video on it someday. I certainly think there are a lot of problems with the Electoral College, but I think that a lot of the problems it has are quite similar to the problems that you have when you try to pick a prime minister through a parliamentary system. I think that Americans tend to really exaggerate the degree that the Electoral College is some uniquely terrible American thing, as opposed to just one of many very flawed systems that we humans use to pick our leaders. Ian the Gecko asks, which is the better airline, Air Canada or WestJet? These are Canada's two national airlines, and God, that's a monstrous choice. I guess I would just say WestJet, because I feel like all good Canadians know that they're supposed to hate Air Canada. Kenny Lovegren asks, tell us about yourself as a teenager. Ah, well, I did not actually have a very interesting teenagehood. I was relatively popular in high school because of how eccentric I was, which I know is something I should be very grateful for, because certainly there's a lot of the, you know, eccentric kids that are not so well received. My teenage years were also when I developed a lot of the base knowledge that I have now, which was in part a reflection of just how much free time I had to learn things. My advice to teenagers is to always take advantage of this opportunity you have to learn as much as you can, because you will be very surprised at the degree that adult you is dependent on your teenage self. And lastly, Michaela Afrique asks, if you could be from any other country in the world, which would you like to be from? That is an interesting one. I think it would be really interesting to be from some very small, isolated country, like the Solomon Islands or something. Assuming I would still be living the same life I have now, but have a different origin story, I think it would be useful to have come from someplace very, very different. I think it would give me a deeper appreciation for some of the vast disparities between how different people on this world live. Alrighty, so that was a lot of questions. Thank you so much for everybody who submitted them. If I didn't answer your question, it was absolutely nothing personal. Although it is also entirely possible that if I didn't answer your question, it's because I answered it in one of my previous Q&A videos. So check those out. By the way, have you guys been enjoying the shirt I have been wearing in this video? It is the first piece of official JJ merchandise. You can order one of your own using the link in the thing below. There is no real point to it. It is just based on this thing behind me, which is some sort of generic fried octopus banner I bought at a dollar store in Japan. One of my friends called it the Pepsi Puss, and so that is its name now. I just like it as a symbol for my channel because it's a weird thing from a foreign country, and as we all know, there's nothing I like more than that. Thank you for watching, and I will see you all next week.